Hi, I'm with Photofocus, fill in for license, and our special guest today is fellow Focus author and wedding photographer, Lisa Robinson. Hey, Lisa.
Hey, V, how are you?
Oh, super good. Good. You know, as you know, Levi is out of the country. He adopted another child.
Important stuff.
He's out there picking up his new son, so he's excited.
Yeah.
You're based out of D.C.,
yes, right. I'm currently based out of just outside of D.C. in Virginia, but have been doing quite a bit of work out here in Colorado, which is where I am right now currently, wrapping up some shoots and a bridal show and all kinds of stuff. So,
And for the viewers, there may be a few little delayed because you're broadcasting from a hotel room. That's always the easiest place to broadcast from.
Yes, I did my best, but this is all I could do for this today.
Oh, great. So our topic is going to be the business of wedding photography.
Yep.
So let's pretend I'm a brand new photographer. I'm starting out. What advice would you give me on like contracts?
Have them. I remember starting out.
So what would be your tips for a successful business?
Getting contracts in order is kind of, it's a foundation. You've got to have it. I hear little rumblings here and there from new photographers or new people to the industry where they don't really have an idea of what they should have, what they shouldn't have. You need a contract. It's best to have them in place rather than to wish you had them later. Because sometimes you can't always foresee what is going to happen. You don't know what that client might do or what a second shooter for you might do. And it's in everybody's best interest to just have everything spelled out. So that way everybody's expectations are the same and you can deliver that appropriately. I even have contracts with vendors for sharing images. So, you know, I'm giving a lot of vendors some images for free, but you know, they need to, in return, make sure that I have proper credit and that sort of a thing. So I always make sure that they're aware of things like that. Second shooter contracts, making sure that second shooters know what's expected of them and making sure that they know what I expect of them for the back end. Once they have images, how they can use those images, where they can use those images, where they need to credit, where it's appropriate for portfolio work. It's a tricky situation, but you know I couldn't have started out in this industry without second shooting and being able to display my work. So I want to make sure that that's spelled out for them, that they're allowed to do that and how they're allowed to do that. And in all of this, you can find online templates for these contracts everywhere. PPA is a great resource. There's like the Law Tog, a lawyer turned photographer. And as good as these all sound, and they're coming from great reputable places, you really want to check with a local attorney to make sure that it's complying with all of your local laws. Because what might be lawful in California might not be lawful in Virginia or wherever you may be.
Well, that's great advice. You hit on something which I really liked. Trust a lawyer. Talk to a lawyer.
Yes.
You know, we joke, Jack Rosnicki. You know, him and Ed do the copyright zone. And I love what he always says. A photographer, I wouldn't come to Lisa and say, hey, Lisa, my tooth hurts. What should I do? You're going to say, Vanelli, go see a dentist.
Right.
So why do photographers go to other photographers and ask them legal advice?
So yeah.
I love what you said, and check with what happens in D.C. may be different, or the laws in D.C. are different from the laws in New York. So,
and one in some cases... I was going to say, in some cases, even county laws can conflict with what is in a contract, depending on what county you're working out of. So it's always best to talk to a local lawyer and really get the skinny on what needs to happen and what you can and can't do.
Now, I like one thing you said, vendor contracts. This is the first time I heard, which I thought was pretty cool. You actually work with the vendors and you let them use some of your images. How does that work? Is it for publicity?
Working in weddings, it's a huge group effort to pull off a wedding. And as a photographer, I'm the only one that really has good pictures of everybody else's work that they've done, you know, from the florist to the catering to the venue to all those things. And, you know, those are expensive for those people to produce if they wanted to produce professional level photos. And since we're working on the same event, it's kind of a little bit of a goodwill thing where I let them use some images for their publicity so long as they credit me. And it's, you know, it helps get my information out there as well as helps them get their work out there. But I don't want to necessarily just give away my stuff for free without getting anything from it. So I want to make sure that they know how they're supposed to credit me, where they're supposed to credit me, how, you know, and all of those types of things.
Good. And I think that's what you just touched base on, I think was great for networking. And I really like how you brought that apart because I didn't even think about vendors. And what's going to end up happening is somebody goes to a person, let's say who's making the cake, they may say, can you recommend a photographer? Mm-hmm. If you're working with them, they'll recommend you.
Right. If somebody's giving you great images and they've been easy to work with and they're very clear and upfront in their communication, it's a win for everybody. And it was really helpful in the industry.
Oh, wow. That sounds great. Now, let's go into, I'm just getting started. So I need to incorporate and I need to register my, register properly. What advice do you have for that?
Register your business legally. Go to your state corporation commission. Again, you can also talk to a local lawyer about how to do this. They're a great resource. Even services online like LegalZoom do a really good job of knowing what you need to do within your state, where you are. And they even have advising services that will essentially be your personal lawyer for you, even though it's kind of virtual based. Okay, you need to fill out this form, you need to fill out that form, and here's what you need to do to get registered for taxes properly, and here's, you know, where you need to go. Some of them even go so far as to giving you a schedule for when what taxes are due. Going hand in hand with this, talking to an accountant, because getting your company set up properly that way is really advantageous as well. I don't know, we took... I think 2 or 3 years before we went from independent contractors to a fully certified LLC. And I don't know why we didn't do it sooner. There's great tax advantages. And then there's also a lot of protections that come with being formally incorporated. Should a client have an issue or anybody have, heaven forbid, some reason to come after you, if there's some sort of wrongdoing, when you're protected as an LLC, they can't come after your personal assets. If you're just out there as an independent contractor, all your stuff is fair game. If somebody decides they want to pursue something and each take you out of house and home, truthfully. So get incorporated. It's super important. And it's really not hard.
And then you were talking about the advantage of the 1099-ing. What did you mean?
More the disadvantage. Disadvantage of tax.
The disadvantage. I mean,
yeah. The tax rate's a lot higher, and you aren't able to do as many deductions for business expenses and such things like that as you are when you're incorporated. So it's just all around. We saved so much money once we started incorporating, and when you're working for yourself, every little penny counts.
Gotcha. Now, for people that are just joining us, I'm with fellow Focus. Author Lisa Robinson and wedding photographer. She's gonna be able to answer any of your questions. So if you have a question in the chat, just click on chat, type out the question, or even just say hi, let us know who's here. Say hi, and then at the end of the broadcast, we're gonna give away Perfectly Clear. So if any of you have questions for her, we just got done talking about the tips to become a successful photo business. She talked about contracts, and she also talked about why it's important to incorporate. Now, from here, what about insurance, Lisa?
Insurance has saved my butt. you need insurance. Any responsible business owner is going to need insurance. Our equipment's expensive. Even lower end equipment is expensive. And it takes years and years and years for everybody to kind of cultivate their gear, their favorite gear package and what they want, what they need. At one point, several years ago, I had all my gear stolen. If I didn't have my insurance, I would have been out like 80 grand worth of information, equipment. And how, as a personal business owner, do I just all of a sudden come up with 80 grand to rebuy back all my stuff? I don't. So $500 deductible, all my stuff was there the next three business days. I had all my stuff replaced from insurance. It's so important. PPA has a great starter insurance that you can build on top of that. It's good for liability and a small amount of physical coverage of items. But most people probably have more than the limit of what that covers. I think it's maybe $5,000 worth of equipment or something like that. Don't quote me. But you can add to that very easily with the insurer that they use. And that's what I do. And it's always been very, very helpful. Also, as a wedding photographer, I'm also in a lot of really nice venues and places, particularly in DC, a lot of historic places. They require me to provide proof of liability insurance. You know, should something happen while I'm photographing, should a client damage something based on where I tell them to go stand for a picture or things like that, I could be held liable if there's damage to the property. So they require me to show that I have that liability policy as well. So it's always a good idea to have. It's really not much money. I think I'm paying $300 or $400 a year for coverage for everything, for my liability, for my equipment, and it's such a small price to pay. It really is.
For your second shooter? So if your second shooter does something,
For liability it does, but it does not cover second shooter's equipment. And my second shooter contract spells out that I'm not responsible for their physical equipment. So should a second shooter drop a lens or break something while they're shooting for me, that's kind of their deal. They should be having their own insurance on that. But I am covered liability-wise with a second shooter.
Now, what about like homeowners insurance or renters insurance? Is that enough or do you need
more? No, homeowners, renters insurance, that stuff does not cover professional use equipment. It would cover your personal camera, your home camera, your vacation camera. But if it's used for business, it legally does not cover that. And I know some people try to fudge that a little bit, but that's not, it's not legal. So best advice is get your business equipment separately insured through a reputable company.
Gotcha. Well, that's great. And again, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them. Just click on the chat window. And then from here, those questions will start to answer them throughout the show itself. Now let's talk about ethics.
Yeah. This is a big separator, differentiator in the market.
All right, fire away.
Well, you know, you always hear horror stories in the wedding industry. You know, the newscasters will get a hold of something where, you know, some bride and groom or some couple has been cheated out of something they bought, or their photographer never delivered photos, or, you know, all these awful things, which nobody wants their business to be associated with for whatever reason. And so, you know, contracts protect you with this. You know, clients know what to expect, when to expect it. If you say, I'm delivering photos in 4 weeks, you deliver photos in 4 weeks. If you say you're going to get back to them at a certain point in time, you get back to them at a certain point in time. It's truly, our word is really all we have to establish ourselves as responsible business owners. And that's what's going to make the difference. If you get back to people quickly, if you get back to them in a pleasant manner, it really makes a difference. I always say, you know, you want to set expectations and then you want to exceed them so that your client's always happy with that. Sometimes, you know, life will happen. You know, I'm out of my main studio right now, so emails are a little bit slower. I've been in the mountains where literally there's not even cell phone connection. You know, make sure you put that away message up so that clients know they aren't just like emailing you and you're off in the ether and they're going, well, she disappeared on me. You know, let them know with the away message. Hey, you know, I'm out of the office. I can't get to you. I will be back on this date. Or say, you know, you get really ill and you fall behind on your editing schedule and that 4-week time of delivery isn't going to happen. Be honest, you know, call them up, tell them what's going on, apologize, say, hey, I'm really sorry. This is kind of the deal. Can I please deliver these to you on X date or what have you? Sure, they might be a little bummed out, but they're going to be far more appreciative that you took the time to give them the truth and not some brush off story about something. So clients can read through that. If you're trying to fudge an excuse, they're going to feel that, and that's not going to bode well for your reputation.
Gotcha. Now, for those who are joining us, Lisa's in a hotel in Colorado, so her connection is a little spotty. So sometimes she's cutting in and out, but there's a slight delay in some of the stuff that she's saying. But I'm hearing.
Sorry.
No, it's not your fault. But now, interesting. We're talking about ethics right now. How do you feel about that wedding photographer that says, "My photos later." Or I don't care what I have to do to get the shot, I'm going to get it. Or let's say a priest or a clergyman says to them, hey, no flash photography, but they sneak it in anyways. What's your advice about that?
I don't think you'll last very long in the business. You know, there's always going to be a segment of clients that condone that. But in my opinion, I don't think that that's worth it. My personal opinion as a wedding photographer, it's my client's day, and this is a very important thing to them. It's not my show to disrupt. I think I should be a good enough photographer to capture a beautiful moment of that without impeding on their space. So I do everything in my power to follow the rules. News also travels really fast within the industry. If you're kind of a bully with your photos and things like that, and you step on people's toes, you're going to find a lot of people don't give out your recommendations because they just don't want to work with you because you're kind of a hassle. So it really is lead by example. Do what you say you're going to do and don't be a jerk about it. And recommendations will flow in from there.
Hey, that's great. Now, Lisa, I wrote an article a while back, excuse me, about is formal education necessary? Mm-hmm. And I give the pros and cons to both. What are your thoughts on investing in education?
Through my story, I went through a formal education in photography. I went to college for photography. I have a formal analog background in film and medium format and even some large format photography as well. And I feel like it really did help me. It gave me a really great foundation. I have a minor in art history, which was a lot of focus on photography history. And I think it's really great to have that base to come from to know where you want to go. You kind of see what's out there, you learn about all of it, and you can kind of craft it into your own. So whether you find that through a formal education like I did, or you find it through your own self-study of history, your own self-study of photography, finding sites like Photofocus, you know, where we have great articles for people getting started, and we kind of have a very well-rounded library on that. Whether you find a workshops, seminars, that sort of thing to practice your skill sets on, just educate yourself. You can't go into this as, oh, well, I just like taking pretty pictures of my kids, and you just all of a sudden start taking pictures. It's not kind of the best approach to go through it, because then you're learning on your paying clients, and I don't think that's fair to clients. Paying clients are where you apply what you've learned. It's not where you do your learning. So whatever you do, be a lifelong student. Always seek out information. Always learn. I think it's really important. Workshops are great. Oh, let's grab at that. And mentorships as well. There's a local photographer that you really like, and sometimes even, you know, you can do this online as well if the photographer's not in your area. Don't be afraid to ask about a mentorship. And they can give you great feedback. It can be like getting critiques, you know, whatever your schedule is. Once a month, you send them a batch of photos and they give you, sit down and have critique. But be prepared to pay for it. These people are essentially giving you an education, and you can't necessarily expect them to educate you for free. So they can be great resources, but yeah.
Well, that's great.
Kind of my thoughts.
Now, how have you been with your mentorships? Who do you look for? Like, if somebody comes up to you and says, hey, I really love your work, mm-hmm. would you mind, you know, helping me out? What's your procedure on that?
A lot of it depends on what part of the season they contact me in. If they contact me in the fall, it's you know, I'm sorry, I don't have the free time for this at the moment, you know, and maybe pick something up with them in winter or spring when my schedule is not quite so crazy. But yeah, I want to look for a student who is open to learning, somebody who really has a thoughtful eye, somebody who asks good questions and doesn't just expect me to do things for them, or you got to have good communication for it to work.
Oh, perfect. Now, Facebook, are you part of any of the Facebook groups, and do you see value in that if you are?
Oh yeah, Facebook groups are great. I'm in probably more than a dozen of different Facebook groups for different areas. It can be a great resource for maybe finding some people, a group of people that want to go out and practice a particular skill that you want to go practice, which is great because, like I said before, you shouldn't be practicing on client time. You should just be applying what you've learned and expanding on it at that point. So finding like-minded people that, hey, you know, I'm really struggling with off-camera flash. Can we all like go one evening and just play somewhere and, you know, figure out settings and things like that? So Facebook groups are great for that. They're also great for bouncing ideas around. If you're like, I'm always running into one particular problem, you can put it out there and say, hey, is anybody else running into this? And generally you'll get, oh yes, I have this and this is what fixed it. So those can be great resources of community as well.
Oh, that's great. That is absolutely great. Now, it's funny when you're mentioning about the seeing what's hip and what's new. You know, we've all done this, I'm sure. Black and white, and then just a touch. The rose is just.
Oh, red. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Selective color.
And we've all done it, but so I guess the trick is to make sure you find out the trends. What are things that are going to be. Like, you look at some of the old photos of JFK's wedding. I mean, I even look at the photos of my parents' wedding, and it's a classic, very beautiful, you know, photos. Those things stand the test for time. You know, what are some things you see that you feel that are like, oh my God, how the heck did they get to that? You know, such like the, you know, pure black and white, and all of a sudden, just a touch.
So what do I see as trendy?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Can you rephrase the question?
In other words, what do you notice are some trends that you wouldn't want to do? I know the Instagram pictures were big for a while.
To me, my only pet peeve right now is there's a trend in editing to like really crush the blacks and the whites, where you don't actually have a pure white and you don't have a pure black. And they call it film look, which is totally not film if you've ever actually shot film. It's not what film looks like. So that kind of gets my goat a little bit. But, I've seen that trend kind of evolve, and it's being applied in different ways now. So I don't know if it'll eventually cycle out. I'm sure most things do eventually cycle out. But that's really the only thing that kind of bugs me is I really... And it's probably my traditional background in everything and analog, you know, zone system, Ansel Adams, having your pure blacks all the way up to your pure whites. So,
gotcha.
but it's definitely a popular style. So
now let's talk about what everyone loves to talk about, tools, the tools of the trade. Yes. I'll make it quick. My son, you know, Alec, of course, he was he decided to pick up a four sport in school. And he picked up bowling. Mm-hmm. I entered the bowling alley and I walk in with my camera to photograph the team. And his bowling coach said, "Wow, if I had a camera like yours, I bet you I could take photos just like you." So of course I turned to his bowling ball and said, "Is that your bowling ball? Wow, if I had a bowling ball like yours, I bet you I could bowl like you." And he literally looked at me with a stunned look and said, "Oh no, it takes a long time to practice this stuff." So with you, what's your take on gear?
You know, there's a lot of gearheads out there, and if that's your thing, that's pretty cool. But I feel like I've found more often than not, you need less than you think. You'll really, it'll take time for you to figure out what you like and what is the gear that gives you the look that you want. But once you do, you're going to have your favorite two, maybe three lenses, and that's going to be it. You're going to have tools that you need. If you need off-camera flash, you're going to have what you need, but you're not necessarily going to have every modifier that's out there. All these little accessories and things, a lot of them are extraneous. And really there's ways that you can achieve your look without having to have, you know, five bags of gear on location. More often than not, you can travel much lighter than you think you can.
Well, that's great. Now, you also brought up a good point. We talked about this before. Instead of just quickly going out buying the new piece of gear, mm-hmm. renting it is to borrowing it from a friend.
Renting or borrowing, if you have a friend that's awesome enough to lend you a lens for a bit, even if you're shooting in their company with their lens. This workshop I was just doing, case in point, a girl was said offhand to me. She's like, "Yeah, I really need to get that 85. I think that's going to be my next lens, but I don't know." And I was like, "Oh, well, I have one if you want to shoot with it and check it out. See what you like." You know, within 5 minutes, she came back to me. She said, "You're not getting this back. I love it." So it was a way to confirm that was going to be the right purchase for her. You know, all this stuff is really expensive. A lot of places don't take purchases back if once you have bought them. So it really does behoove you to make sure that it is a purchase that you really want. Lens rentals, borrow lenses, parachute. There's all kinds of companies out there that you can rent gear from pretty easily and honestly fairly inexpensively. If you can spend, you know, 3 or 5% of the cost on a lens to confirm that is in fact what you want to spend, you know, $1,400, $1,500, $2,000, whatever dollars on, it's money well spent.
Great. Now, just for people joining us, we're halfway through our session and I'm here with Lisa Robinson, fellow Focus writer and author. She's also an incredible wedding photographer. And this whole webinar is sponsored by our friends over at AthenTech, makers of Perfectly Clear. So on that note, what is some of your software, your go-to?
You know, honestly, 95% of what I do, I'm able to do just within Lightroom for as far as editing goes. There are a few plugins that I really enjoy, and they kind of end up being like the little cherry on top that just like tweaks the photo just enough to make it really something special. And I use that on my feature images, the portrait session within the wedding. But other than that, it's right in through Lightroom. The plugins that I really enjoy, I really do enjoy the Perfectly Clear for eyes specifically. Like what it does for, there's the facial slimming, which is great because sometimes people just end up photographing a little bigger than they necessarily appear in real life. Lenses can kind of accentuate that, and Perfectly Clear's facial slimming is really awesome for just tweaking that right back into making that person look as they appear in real life to you. And also, I've found their under eye circles, that feature to be just awesome. Like, it's so much easier than when I would used to go into Photoshop and have to manually retouch all the under eye areas. So that makes my life super easy. And then the other ones, Nick Software, which Google bought. I love their black and white effects. I can't seem to replicate what I want to replicate for black and whites just within Lightroom. Like using their tools is just amazing. They have really great film profiles that I know are near and dear to my heart from my analog background. I can go in and be like, oh, there's my Ilford 400 and get that look that I remember always having. So those are kind of my two things that I do. So it's not a ton of stuff, but like when I need those things, it really gets the job done.
Great. Now, you know, it's interesting because I hear, or I read, I should say, you know, in a lot of the Facebook groups, oh, I just got done doing wedding, I'll be up all night editing. Mm-hmm. Questioning, what do you mean you're going to be up all night editing? If you just came back from the wedding, why are you going to spend 10 hours editing all these images? What's your advice on that?
Well, I go to bed after a wedding. But, you know, I make sure my stuff's backed up and then I go to bed. But editing's a long process. I mean, wedding day, you know, 8, 9, 10 hour day, you're shooting 3, 4, 5,000 images and getting through culling down those images to the ones you want to end up delivering to the client. It takes time. And even doing small edits, you know, when you add it up over hundreds or thousands of images, it's hours and hours of work. So
now, and keep in mind that that's where, again, not just because Perfectly Clear is sponsoring this, but for any of the stuff I do a lot of the sports stuff. Mm-hmm. I run my whole process through Perfectly Clear, and it takes care of all my sport images. So I look at the sports stuff for you. Exactly. So it's very similar to wedding. And it's so funny because I tell people I don't like photographing weddings because I don't like the pressure of missing that special moment. Mm-hmm. But then it dawned on me doing sports, the same concept. You don't want to miss that special moment. But this is where Perfectly Clear comes in for me. I get batch process. But what comes through just work. You come home, you dump it to your computer, go to bed, wake up. Mm-hmm. Then what do you do from there?
From there, I separate into groups based on what part of the day it was, whether it was pre-wedding, the formals, the ceremony, you know, all the different sectors of the day. And then from that sector, after I've made sure all my metadata tagging is done, I go through and I call down. And I probably deliver about 10%. So it's a very tight call. It's the best of the best. My clients aren't going to get any of the riffraff. And there's kind of a joke in photography and in design. Designers know this as well. You know, if you give your client three options and you like A and you like B and you kind of just threw a C in there just because, like, but you don't really love it, inevitably that's going to be the one the client loves and like throws everywhere. And you're like, oh God, why did I give that to them? Because it doesn't represent you personally. So I do a very tight call on what things I deliver. So that also helps me not waste time editing. I wish I could do more batch processing. I haven't found a batch process method that really works for me. And I think it's because within weddings, there's so many different lighting situations during the day. Like I can batch little chunks, but I can't batch big chunks because batch processing only really works if you can come to the same neutral level to begin with and then apply the exact same correction over top of that. So there's smaller chunks I can do in a wedding day, but not, you know, from noon to midnight. You know, it's gonna be processed differently because they just look different.
Gotcha. Now you actually use a dry erase board, right? To spell things out.
Yeah. I know there's lots of awesome online tools and computer tools and things like that, but being a very visual person, I have a massive dry erase board that has my entire workflow, and I can just, I have client name, their date, you know, has their contract been paid? When's the next meeting? The notes, where it's at, is it in the call? Is it in the edit? Is it posted online yet? Have they been notified? Is it on album yet? Like every little teeny bit of the workflow I have on there. So at a glance, I can look up and see, oh gosh, I have a lot of stuff that's waiting for an album. Like, I really need to get on my albums now and do that. Or, oh yeah, everybody's notified. Everybody's got their stuff. All their USBs have been delivered. Everything's good. I'm done. Check it off. Done. So for me, that's what works. But there are definite advantages to having some web and cloud-based systems, like the 17 Hats and like the Pixifys, that in addition to helping you with online contracts and client communication and taking payments, it also helps you with a workflow. You can do your workflow online there as well, instead of having the old school dry erase board like I do.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Now, do you personally use 17 Hats?
I don't personally use it. I've done some trials of things, and inevitably I stupidly always try to do it in like the busiest time of year. So I don't devote enough time to just sit down and get the lay of the land properly. So that might be something I'm going to be doing in the near future, is checking out some things. I hear those Facebook groups that we talked about, those are also good places to throw questions like this out there, saying, hey, what works for you?
You were talking about some of the photo sites, treat them with respect.
Some of the photo sites, treat them with respect.
When you're on location.
On location photo sites. Yeah. That kind of comes back to the insurance and stuff like that. And you'll run into a lot of venues that have weird rules about things that you can and can't do. And some of them are super restrictive, and it's frustrating. And then you realize they have these rules because some yahoo has destroyed this before, or, you know, put people on top of like a sacred statue that's totally trashing somebody's religion by, you know, making somebody sit on top of it, and it's completely rude and disrespectful. So it just makes things even harder for everybody else, because then they tend to clamp down on rules even more than they need to, because somebody has ruined something before for everybody else. So, you know, treat all your sites with respect. If you want to be able to come back to them, you know, don't leave trash laying around. Don't break things. I've seen people go into beautiful gardens or botanical gardens and put clients in there, and then like they're trying to get a shot, but there's a branch in the way, so they break the branch off. Like, why would you do that? That now, you know, the botanical garden is just gonna be like, nope, can't do photography here. Sorry. And you've completely ruined a beautiful site for potentially hundreds of other photographers because you decided to destroy their property. It's senseless, and it just makes everybody else's life a lot harder. So treat all your photo sites with respect, treat the people that are there with respect, and clean up after yourself.
Great, great advice. And I think that was something you and I were talking about before.
Yeah, it was.
I've heard of people literally just sticking their camera right in the middle, you know, of the kiss or the ring. And,
oh yeah,
you know, they don't listen to what the people say. They just do it. And all of a sudden, they wonder why, when they get to the venue, that the person in charge is really upset towards photographers. So I like what you were saying about the respect. So
yeah, I've had the door of a church shut in my face because they said that photographers weren't allowed on the ground floor, and I had to find a side door in the building and go up back stairs to get up to a balcony before, and because somebody was a jerk at some point, I presume, because there's no reason for that. But yeah, it certainly makes everybody else's life a lot difficult if you're disrespecting and trashing sites.
Wow. Now, again, if you're joining us, we're about 20 minutes away from finishing up with Lisa. I'm Vanelli, filling in for Lisa Sims, and our topic is on the business of wedding photography, and it's sponsored by Perfectly Clear, or AthenTech, makers of Perfectly Clear. If you have a question, please put the question out for us, and it's a perfect time to pick Lisa's brain and ask her. So we just finished up talking about respecting the location that you're on. Now let's talk about networking.
Networking's great. Networking's a really vital piece of this puzzle, I think. Going to networking events is great. Meeting people is great. But a lot of networking events are kind of just a handshake and a business card exchange and, you know, maybe a minute or two of talking to each other. So if you find somebody that you think you connect with, that you like their work, you're interested in working with them, make sure that you follow up. Because all too often, you know, you get stacks of cards and you've never done anything with them. And those are all missed opportunities for either a recommendation at the very least, if not collaborative work on top of that. So yeah, you really want to make sure that you do that. And then the second part B to following up, give them a reason why they want to network with you. You know, if you're just always taking from everybody, why would they want to give any more? You know, you got to give something back to them, give them a reason why your photography is the photography that they want to be working with, and why you are the right photographer to be working with them as well.
Great. Kevin asked, when networking, what are some of the groups that you work with locally?
There's local chamber of commerce groups. There are local photography groups. I do a lot of those because it's great for second shooting referrals. It's great for when somebody's busy and they're passing off a wedding to somebody else. Like, hey, I'm booked. Who wants this wedding? Those are great resources for business. There are local BNI groups. If you find the right BNI, it's definitely worth your time. I've found in my area, there's very few wedding focused BNIs. So a lot of them are more corporate and it doesn't really work for me because everybody's just like, hey, can you do my headshot? And I'm like, I don't do headshots. So, and really like, it's hard for me to refer a plumber when I'm a photographer. Like it happens every once in a blue moon, but yeah. So if you can find like a wedding centric, if you're a wedding photographer.
That's where you send your intern. That's where you send your intern or somebody shadowing you and have them go over and do it for you.
Yeah, that's true as well. There's a lot for wedding groups. There's a lot of wedding and event groups that have monthly meetings and local meetings and open meetings and things like that. So looking for those types of wedding or event groups can be a good resource as well for networking groups.
Gotcha. Now, last, you talked about giving thanks. What do you mean by that? Giving thanks to what?
Giving thanks to everyone, to anyone. You know, we can't do this business alone. We can't, you know, be photographers without having clients that want to work with us and without having clients that want to refer us. We can't, you know, we can't work these weddings without vendors that help us, enable us to do what we do, you know, particularly planners. A good planner can make or break a success of photography if they're, you know, bullying the timeline and saying you have to be done now versus someone who goes, I know these are important. What can I do so you can get the client what they need? You know, there's all sorts of people that play a role in you having a successful business in addition to your own hard work. So making sure that they know that you appreciate it, making sure they, you know, your clients feel appreciated. They feel like they've spent their money in a good way. You know, putting it out there verbally, and then also never underestimate the power of a handwritten note. Just sending a little thing saying, hey, you know, I really appreciated you sticking up for the timeline and allowing me a little extra 30 minutes to photograph the couple. They totally love their images and it was the best thing. Or, you know, telling that client, oh, that was really nice of you. You got me like the most beautiful vendor meal. It was so delicious. It was so great to have after, you know, a 10-hour day to have a nice hot meal at your wedding reception. Thank you. You know, they're kind of innocuous on their own, but you begin to get known for somebody who's grateful and thankful to work with good people. And that just attracts more good people and then makes your business happier and healthier to run all the way around.
Well, that's great. And again, for those that are just joining us, I'm with Lisa, and we're talking about the business of wedding photography. She's in a hotel room in Boulder, Colorado, so her connection is coming in and out. So, but you could hear, I mean, 99% of the stuff talking about, she just got done talking about giving thanks and giving back to the community. So now Perfectly Clear is the sponsor of this webinar. And at the end, we're gonna give away a complete set of Perfectly Clear, which will be an incredible addition to your photography. Now, hey, Lisa, you have some images to show us?
I do. Can I add one thing to giving thanks?
Yep.
Before we move on?
Yep.
One thing I wanted to touch on was a lot of photographers will give their, or you'll see them giving out like Christmas gifts and things like that, or holiday gifts, or sending their clients things after weddings, which is great. But it can be expensive, even if you choose like a small gift, you know, that ends up being $5 and then shipping is $5. And then, you know, you're multiplying that times 30 or 40 clients and all of a sudden you're into a lot of money. My point to that is if you want to do that, that's awesome, but make sure that it's something that's a value add to your client. I see a lot of like little trinkets and going out, but those just get thrown into a drawer and never see the light of day. If it's something the clients have value in or find value in, they're going to show their friends and then that's going to end up coming back to you. It's kind of like being dollars in a way. If you are going to give thanks object, make sure that it's going to be something that's eventually going to end up fitting them but benefiting you. So that's what I wanted to say about that.
Yep. It's funny you're saying that because I received a Christmas gift from a company that I do a lot of stuff for, and this is a multi-billion dollar company. And some of the stuff we received, it was interesting what they sent. And like you said, it didn't really reflect the company. You know, I would rather a nice shirt with a company name on it or something that reflected more of the company. So, but that's a great advice on that. So are you ready to show us some of your pictures?
Sure. What would you like to see? Let me get my screen going here.
Do you have any sports photos you want to show us?
Nope. None of that. Unless you count horses. I got some horse stuff, but you know, that's about all I got here. So I'm screen sharing now. Why is Java coming up? Sorry. Derp. All right.
Here we go.
Here's some pictures. So
we'll just take a few minutes to talk about each of these. Right. We have about 10 minutes left. If you have a question for Lisa, now is a perfect time to start asking them.
All right. So this is just one of my favorite pictures. I love just the...
Okay, what was your thought process on this? Because people will say, well, why did you cut the face off? I love it.
I find I take a lot of wide pictures, so I was really trying to force myself into kind of breaking a pattern and getting closer. And when you get closer, you really focus on that intimate connection between a couple. And I just loved this embrace. It was sweet. It was tender. It was strong. It was all of those things about this couple who've been through, personally, they've been through a lot and distance and things like that. And I just thought it was a really appropriate choice of framing to convey that feeling.
Exactly. See, when I see this, I'm looking at the sacrifice the man's making, you know, for our country.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And the sacrifice the wife is going to make not having him with her. You're not having him, you know, with her, especially right after the wedding, you know, if you were overseas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they have a lot of that going on in their life. And that embrace was important to me and I wanted to focus on that.
Yeah, definitely.
Kind of the same thing here with this couple, just a quiet moment and these beautiful spring blossoms. Loved that. Is it changing for you on that end, V?
Yep, look, we got it. It's looking great.
Awesome. All right. Here, just wanting to play with movement through veils and playing a little bit with that sun flare. Like that, I like it coming in there. Sometimes sun flare gets in your way, and sometimes I feel like it adds to a composition. And here, I really enjoyed it. And it brings your focus right down into this happy moment between these two.
Did you switch?
I did switch.
Yeah, there's a slight delay. Now, oh, beautiful.
This was awesome because it was right after a crazy, crazy thunderstorm that nearly like blew the venue over. It was insane. It was one of those like microburst kind of storms. And I thought it was the perfect chance to play with a little off-camera flash so that we really got all those vibrant hues and the textures and the clouds coming out. So I was really happy about that. But again, you know, like me, I like to shoot wide and shoot the environment. So this is kind of quintessentially that. And then this one is a similar story to the last one, only no storm, just a beautiful sunset in Aruba on the beach. And these two really enjoying it on the night before their wedding. Did it switch over?
No, not yet. It's about two. Good.
We'll do a couple. Oh, yeah. Technology.
Yeah. Well, it's that hotel. Yeah. You know what? Let's try hit go out of full screen for a moment. In Lightroom.
Yep.
Yep. Now is it sure still? Yeah, there's that major. Oh, there it is. All right, let's look at, oh, there it goes. All right, how about you go to the next one? Oh, nice.
Yeah, I love shooting through things and kind of back to where I'd said, you know, some people will shoot through the beautiful botanics and they'll just like snap off a branch if it doesn't work for them. I didn't do that here. You know, I'm finding the little pockets, the natural pockets within shrubbery. In this case, I think it was a tree, like a willow low-lying kind of tree that I was shooting through to get this little picture. And the bokeh that it creates with the out of focus and the layering, I really am into that kind of a scene.
Ooh, very dramatic.
Very dramatic. Again, trying to get the skies. I like a black and white sky. Some people don't. I think it can be really fun, especially within this composition that's so almost mirrored with the way that the tree line reflects in the lake there. This was just a simple one. This is at the Franciscan Monastery in Washington, D.C. And I wanted to really make sure I incorporated that environment because it was important to them and their wedding to be married there.
Oh, nice. Very nice.
More layering. This is in Georgetown in Washington, D.C. So again, a very historic place. Wanted to capture those old factories and with the new bridges and kind of just the little bit of the bushes really frames in onto the client, which is great.
Now, how was that communicating with them?
I was shouting. It was pretty funny. I prepped them mostly beforehand. And then there were a lot of hand signals because it was actually probably about 40 yards away from me, using a telephoto again to compress that space, to really make it stand out. So it was a little comical, but, we made it work. It actually only took, two takes to get this one. So, they were awesome. They were good listeners. and then here, this kind of is like the first one, and I wanted that embrace and that holding of the client to kind of come out, but I wanted to do it in a different way. So I decided to like peek up under her veil and see what I got and really draw that connection to, you know, hands holding each other.
We have time for two more.
Ooh, okay. This, I just love, these are Colorado natives who just love the mountains and love each other. And it's very simple and straightforward that's exactly what this is.
Okay. I like how you tie in their personal, like you just said here, they love the mountains, they're in Colorado. So I love how you tie in their life. So when you see this, they can relate to the image.
Right. That's important. If they don't relate to the image, they're not going to love the image. And if they don't love the image, they're not going to show everybody the image. And then if you don't show anybody the image, then you have no new stream of clients or reinforcing your brand as this awesome thing with people who are super appreciative of what you do. So finding all those little elements and ways to incorporate it is important. And then this here, I loved the light. It was actually a hay barn on this farm property. And, you know, wherever the light transitions from bright to dark, there's a really beautiful sweet spot of this beautiful diffused light. And I utilized that to my advantage. You know, no matter where you are, whether you're in a parking garage or in a hotel or at a window, there's always, just before you go into the super bright, this just magic spot that makes skin glow. And I didn't retouch her skin at all, and she's just radiating. It's awesome.
And then also point out to the right of it how you incorporate an out of focus element.
Yeah, there was a post here because there was like tractor equipment and really distracting things to the composition. So by using my telephoto to compress that space and including just a little bit of that post that I knew would blur out, it just ever so subtly brings your eye back to the couple and not to anything distracting in the background.
We're going to make t-shirts that says I'm an out of focus element. Only photographers would understand what that means.
Yeah.
But that's beautiful, Lisa. Hey, so let's go back to you to see you.
To see me.
Hello. So I'm Vidali with Photofocus, and I'm filling in for Levi Sim. And we just got done with a beautiful webinar with wedding photographer Lisa Robinson. She's also a Photofocus author. You can find a lot of her stuff online. We really want to thank our sponsor, AthenTech, makers of Perfectly Clear, for hosting this event. So Lisa, you did an amazing job. Thank you so much. Well, now, thanks. We do have a winner.
And oh, our yay. Winner
for the Perfectly Clear is Kevin McSpearin.
Yay, Kevin.
Congratulations, Kevin. I'll get all your information, Kevin, and I'll have Perfectly Clear send out the information for you.
So, you want me to show real quick how I use Perfectly Clear with the eyes and stuff?
Yes. Yep.
I think we have a minute for that. So
let's do that.
I really wanted to show that because it really it lives up to the hype on that as far as I'm concerned.
And so do you like the eyes?
So here's an original picture here, the first one. And she looks pretty good. You know, there's not a whole lot to really complain about in this image. But, you know, down here, it's a little dark and that sort of a thing. So when I go to my Perfectly Clear, there's just ever so slightly a change here. It smooths out that skin tone. It gets rid of that teeny tiny bit of under eye circle that she has here. And it just is such a nice little pop
addition to it.
Yeah. Same thing with this image. You know, they have very dark features, dark eyes, dark hair. So I'm wanting to lighten that up a little bit right here. Boom. Particularly on the groom, like looking at his under eye circles in this area, all of a sudden they just magically disappear. Zoom in more. Yeah.
Let's see if that'll work.
So
there you go.
So there's the old, and then with Perfectly Clear. Such a sweet, subtle change that makes all the difference in the world, and was like 10 seconds of post-processing.
Now, what's funny about that is, excuse me, with Perfectly Clear, we were in London, and they were asking questions about underneath the eyes, and I call them raccoon eyes.
Uh-huh.
And Brad, the founder, and of AthenTech said, well, what are raccoon eyes? So I explained the dark circles and stuff underneath. Uh-huh. And about 3 months later, Harrington sends me a little note and says, check out Perfectly Clear and look at the new raccoon eyes. And I think it's the coolest thing that this company listens to photographers. Mm-hmm. And they pick our brains and they ask us, you know, what can we do to make our software better? So yeah. That's great to have a company that actually listen to photographers and applies the things that we tell them.
Yeah, I mean, it just amazes me, like looking on her here, right, in her eye here, you know, in the old version, which this is, I wouldn't necessarily call that dark circles, But all of a sudden I'm like, oh yeah, that really was a dark circle. And it preserves the skin texture so beautifully, which I was never able to replicate when I was having to go in and do this manually within Photoshop. It would always look a little bit not right because you can't replicate those tiny little folds of skin texture. That was just amazing to me. And then this last one with this cute pup. Both of them have really just come a long way.
Oh, wow. Yeah. You know, and it's safe to say, I do a lot of studio work in the studio. So for me to get rid of that on set is where I would hire a makeup artist. And a makeup artist would come in and remove what I need. Obviously, for wedding, you do have a makeup artist, but that poor bride is going through the entire day without touch-ups. You know, here, fortunately, we're makeup.
Yeah, even here, she had professional makeup, and you know, it's still on top of that.
You still need it.
So, yeah. So
well, that's great.
That's what I mean with plugins. That's what I was meaning earlier about it's how it's kind of like my little cherry on top with plugins. It's
exactly
not meant to be my full edit, but it just makes that little bit going that extra mile. It makes it better.
Well, the rule of thumb is simple. If the subject's own mother can recognize them, then you go just a lot. Back it off to where it's still believable it's them, but you know, you see something special with it. So
the best version.
Lisa, again, thank you so much for taking time out. And I know you're out there in Colorado. So to spend an extra hour with us on this and to help everyone, we really appreciate that. So
absolutely. Thanks again, for having me.
And for our friends over at AthenTech, thank you so much for helping sponsor this broadcast and for giving Kevin a copy of Perfectly Clear. Thank you.
Thank you.
Three.